I'm usually a morning person, but when everybody's hungover, I think it's better to have the afternoon session, even if it's after lunch. So this is more like a SQL chat. I think a lot of people were there in Jaipur. So how many people were there in Jaipur? Anybody? Show of hands. Okay, great. And does anyone remember anything much about what we talked about? Any? Yeah.
I thought it was more about like crisis management, and then you said within 6 months you were going to move to Himalayas with your wife. So I think the questions were more like, how are you going to sustain? What about kids? What about education? A lot of it was. Of course, you gave us a little background on how you ended up in jail,
since
you said, and then Bad Boys of Bogart, jail your book.
Yes.
I remember. So yeah, it was, and where you are now.
So she got everything, man. Anybody else want to add something?
I'm thinking a lot more than her, so I don't really. I think what really struck me was the fact that you had to have that crisis of understanding what your purpose in life was while you were in jail.
Yeah.
You didn't have that until you sort of went to jail. So for most of us, but
I was not there in Jaipur, but I heard a lot about this before.
Okay, great. So Kunjal more or less got it, but since this is a Kellogg MBA meet, I figured I have to have a chart in my presentation. I can't just have pretty pictures of the mountain, so I got one chart, which I can't show you right now. But it's a very simple chart. It's a cost-benefit chart, and you have benefits which are going downhill, and you have costs which are going the other way around. And this is obviously a very personal perspective, but somewhere I felt that living in the city had a certain cost to it, and there was a certain benefit why you chose to stay in the city. It was a good school, it was a career, it was blah, blah, blah. And for me, those two lines crossed when my son developed this wheezing problem at the age of 6. And the doctor said, it's either the medicine or you have to leave the city. I was in Gurgaon, just to clarify. And when that happened, you really start asking yourself, do I want to put my son on medication because I want to be the CEO of HCL Learning, or I want to be this Mr. Big Shot? When is that really the worthwhile price? And the decision was no. The answer was no. And that's where we then decided that we were going to move away from the city and we were going to move to the mountains. And there was a lot of fuzziness, like Kunjal just said. It wasn't crystal clear. We didn't know exactly what we would do. We didn't have clarity about where we would go and how we would manage things. So it's been 2.5 years now. I did move from September, which is when we had met in Jaipur. March of 2015 is when we moved. We've been there for 2.5 years now. Manab has actually visited because he works with an NGO which is there in the area. And it's been a very interesting journey. It's like from a life update perspective, there was this really hard time because there's no jobs, there's no opportunities, there's no companies or startups to run or anything to do. And the only employment opportunities there are a couple of NGOs, and that's pretty much it. And it's not like they're waiting, and they're highly political organizations. They've both been around for at least 25 years, so that's not what we wanted to do. But for the kids, it's been awesome. They go to a school which is under the mentorship of Rishi Rally, so it's been a really good experience for them. But we're going to hit a crisis again in about a year because my son is now in grade 5, and the school is still grade 5. So we might just have to lift anchor and weigh anchor and move elsewhere. In terms of personal life, what I've done is basically two things. I started something called the Himalayan Writing Retreat. This was a natural outcome of having gotten into writing from Bokaro jail, which is the background. And then from there, having moved on to, I realized that I actually enjoy writing. I'm passionate about it. I have fun doing it. And I love to teach. That's been my background. Even, most of my career has been in training and education organizations. So, you can write and you can teach, but who are you going to teach it to? So we came up with this whole idea of a B2C business, which would be a Himalayan writing retreat. It's very, it's not valuation at all. It's pure lifestyle, passion kind of business, and that's what it's about. And the second project, which is starting off now, which actually has a lot in common with what Brian discussed, was the project that we're starting off where we're going to be making artisan cheese. So the idea is to source milk from the villagers who are right now, they have just one customer, which is the Anchal, which is like the mother dairy of Uttarakhand. And you also employ all the local people, you do all the production in the village. So it's working towards a purpose, like he put. And at the same time, it has to be self-sustainable. I'm not doing it alone. There is a co-founder. And my co-founder is actually a trained chef who's been making cheese for over a year now. So he's going to be the ops guy who really knows how to do all of that stuff, and I'm helping him on the business end of things. So with that backdrop, you know, when you move to the mountains and you've done this for a little while, it's always nice to show pictures just so that people can go ooh and ah. So that's the Himalayan riding retreat. That's the view from my house on a clear day. Can you see the video? Can you see the video?
It's a little different from
Gurgaon. And this is about 30 seconds. And all of these photographs are taken by me. So it's not like anything very professional or fancy. This is dawn. This is taken in February of this year. That set of mountains is Nanda Devi. It's called Trishul. This slide is a photograph of the venue of my next writing retreat. This is called the Binsar Forest Retreat. No, the next one. Yeah. So this is called the Binsar Forest Retreat. It's an awesome place. That's the venue of my next writing retreat. And this is the view of a sunset from that retreat. This is the most important, actually, photograph of all of these. This is, you don't move to the mountains if you don't hike and trek, and we all do. And in this picture, you can see this little red speck here. That's my son. This is taken from last year. The same boy who was 6 years old and had a wheezing problem in Gurgaon, on this particular day, he walked 20 kilometers at the age of 9, and he was perfectly fine. He was tired, but he did not have a wheezing problem. He did not have any issues whatsoever. He was able to walk, and he was... And that one thing has probably made the move completely worth it for me, because my boy is, you know, healthy and hale. Let's move on. So when you move to the mountains and you kind of, you know, go through this whole process, one of the things that you'll end up doing is you look inside, you start introspecting, and it's kind of like, you know the eclipse is coming, so you set yourself up, you get this big telescope, and when you look into it, you realize. So you've got the telescope, you start looking inside, and you look at yourself and you see, okay, what are the actual drivers of my decisions? Success is always linked to a lot of wealth and possessions. The script comes to you from your parents, and then a lot of it is from your peers. So if there's 5 entrepreneurs in the room, it automatically becomes cool to be an entrepreneur. And a lot of moving to the mountains and being on your own and being away from the peer pressure and being away from that set of all those kind of influences makes you question a lot of these things, and that's part of the process that I'm in the middle of right now. And then you go back to the same telescope and you look inside some more, and you actually see a lot of bacteria, and if it's the Kellogg Alumni Association, you see a lot of alcohol. So that's the time when you decide maybe you don't want to talk about looking inside, but you want to talk about something a little different. So that's why I decided that today I'd want to talk a little bit about resilience. I can talk a little bit about this from my personal experience, but we can also have a little conversation about, a lot of the stories. I mean, Brian's story is one of resilience, man. I have to hand it to the guy. He just doesn't give up. And I think that's amazing. And so for me, resilience was, an outcome of going to jail. And I now, of course, having been to jail in the August company of Andy Fastow. Everybody know Andy Fastow? So for those of you who don't, he used to be the CFO of Enron. And he spent 6 years in jail. I spent 1 month. So he went to Kellogg. We went to Kellogg, we went to jail. And we both now are on the public speaking circuit. He, of course, talks about business ethics. So when you move to the mountains, I showed you this pretty picture and made you guys all green and envy, but it's not all pretty. It is very difficult, it can be very, very challenging. And that's a question a lot of people already ask me, saying, okay, what's it like to move to a place like that? And when you hear Taylor Swift, and she says, baby, I'm a nightmare, that's like a daydream, that's really what she's talking about, is moving to the mountains, because it looks very pretty. On the surface, it's all fabulous. But when you get in there, you realize that there's a lot that's difficult, there's lots that's broken, not just personally, but even just the way things exist, all is not hunky-dory. And again, I could relate to a lot of the stuff that Brian was talking about, because the small farmer and the stuff that they have to deal with. So we've actually seen scenarios where we had a pear tree outside the house, and the pears were falling and rotting to the ground, and they were being swept away and thrown away. not even the cows were being fed the pears. And that's because of the market dynamics. Because they did not have a mechanism. So food processing, they did not have a mechanism to take it out on time and process it. And the market would suddenly tank because there is so much production all coming in one shot. So the price would just go through the floor. And it's not even feasible to put it in a box and send it to the mandi. That even that is not feasible. So it was really, there's a lot of things that are on in that world which you kind of understand when you start living in that marketplace. But I diverged. So what I wanted to actually talk about was resilience. And you know, when I went through all of this stuff and first the jail experience and then moving to the mountains, and you know, that was doing it to myself, honestly. But it was a setback in any case. Then it really, I started looking at other people and I started asking myself, okay, who are the other people who've really been through hard times and how have they gotten through them? And what are the three or four things that help you? What are the few things that will help you climb out of a really big hole which you might find yourself in? And there are really three or four simple things that always come out. The first of them, and I don't think if you can have a worse experience than going to a concentration camp, but Viktor Frankl, so he's a psychiatrist, right? He was Jewish, of course. And he spent a long time in a concentration camp. He was one of the survivors who spent years in a concentration camp. He came out strong. He says one thing which is really incredible. He says, we who lived in concentration camps can remember the men who walked through the huts, comforting others and giving away their last piece of bread. They may have been few in number, but they offer sufficient proof that everything can be taken from a man, but one thing, and that the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way. So to me, it was really the attitude. When you go in, when you hit a wall, it can be anything. It can be a divorce, it can be an accident, it can be, you know, disease, it can be professional problems. You go in there and it's your attitude which will determine whether you start asking yourself, why me, what do I do to deserve this, you know, who can I blame? Or you turn it around and you say to yourself, okay, so I'm in this situation, but what can I do about it? How can I make something positive out of it? How can I come out of this stronger than I was before? And what are the tools, what are the options available to me with which I can do something great? And so that's really a very, very basic starting point is the attitude. And how many people have heard of Ole Christensen? Anybody heard of him? Oh, excellent. So I'm glad you haven't. So Ole was a carpenter in the 1930s, and his company or his little business, he used to have about 6-7 other carpenters work for him, and he used to make ironing boards and ladders. And then the Great Depression came along and the entire economy tanked, and he realized that people weren't buying as many ladders and ironing boards anymore. So he switched to something very different, which was very innovative at the time. But he said, I know how to do woodwork and I need to keep my 7 people employed and I have to keep my kids fed. So I'm going to start making toys. And he started making toys. And then 1935 came along and the yo-yo was invented. And again, through making toys, he was able to continue to pay his bills. He was able to continue employing his people. And then he went on to the yo-yo fad, which came and went. And when it came, he created a lot of yo-yos. He had huge inventory, and then the fad vanished, like all fads do. And that's when he realized that he was stuck with a huge amount of stock, and nobody was buying yo-yos anymore. Suddenly, so he realized that he could do something different with them, and he actually took the yo-yos apart and used them as wheels for the toy trucks that he used to make. And that was the basis on which he was able to survive that swing down. And his company still exists, by the way. It's called Lego. So his son ran it, and now I think it's in the third generation. But it's a sign of the resilience, and this is pure creative thinking about how he's being able to manage and run things. He's hit two walls within like 5 years of each other, and he's been able to climb each of them with creativity. This other story is of Victoria Rovolo. Victoria is a 42-year-old woman coming back from piano camp concert, driving home in upcountry New York. As she's driving home, a 20-pound projectile comes through her windscreen and hits her in the face. She has 10 hours of surgery, 2 weeks of induced coma, and when she comes out of the coma, she doesn't know what had happened. She doesn't even know what happened. She had just no idea. And So this is bringing us to the second point of resilience and the whole idea behind resilience, which is our attitude. It lands up coming to mission and purpose, where you have to, often the setback will set you in a whole other direction, and it will have you going at something which you had not thought of as important earlier. So with Victoria Rivolo, when something like this were to happen to you, let's say you were just going along your everyday life, and suddenly everything in your everyday life is just destroyed. It took her 8 months to get back to work. The doctor said you would never go back to work. She did go back to work, but it took her 8 months. And then she found out, and she did some research, and she asked around, how did this happen? And they said that there was this bunch of teenagers who had stolen a credit card, and they bought a frozen turkey. And one guy just threw the frozen turkey from the car in front of her. And that's what came through the windscreen and hit her. Now, the particular boy who threw that, his name was Ryan, and he's 18 years old. And all the other kids in the car became state witness, and they said that we will testify against him. And he was up for a 25-year sentence in prison for his act. Now, if you were Victoria Rivolo, what would you do? You would want to go to the court, you would want to listen to his judgment, and you would want to see him being hanged, or at least being put away for a very long time. She went to the court and she asked for amnesty for him. She said that, can you just let him go, please? The judge said, I can't let him go, he's up for 25 years, but I'll give him 6 months and I'm going to put him on community service. And then I have to read this passage from her book. She's also written a book about it. And it's really the most amazing thing. So she says, once the case was over and it was time for him to walk out, he started veering over towards where I was sitting, and every court officer was ready to jump on him. They had no idea why he was coming towards me. But as he walked over to where I was sitting and stood in front of me, I saw that all he was doing was crying. Crying profusely. He looked at me and he said, I never meant for this to happen to you. I prayed for you every day, and I'm so glad that you're doing well. Then this motherly instinct just came over me, and all I could do was take him and cuddle him like a child and tell him, just do something good with your life. Take this experience and do something good out of it. She's even now dedicating her life. So her entire life is transformed. She continues to dedicate her life to transforming those of teenagers who are lost souls and who don't have direction and who are, going down this wrong path. So, and that's really the second part of resilience, is a lot of it comes back into changing your direction, changing your focus, and wanting you to do something else. The third is something that you wouldn't even imagine, which is really a very, very basic thing, which is take care of yourself. You hit a black spot, you hit something bad. The first thing you do is you let go of your food habits, you let the exercise go, you say, okay, let me deal with this and I'll come back to that stuff later. That's usually a bad idea. Not to be boasting, but when I was in prison, I'm a runner. When I was in prison, the longest run I did inside jail was 20 kilometers. And this is in a yard that was 70 seconds for one loop. So you're talking about maybe like 110 loops. But I kept running when I was in jail because I did not want to let go of this whole, I didn't want this condition, the situation to win over me. I wanted to stay strong. And there's another great way to stay strong, which is mental, which is all of us in this room actually have so much to be grateful for. So even if you were to just make a gratitude journal, and write down every single day for 30 days, when you hit a wall, what are the things that are there in your life that you would feel really proud of, that you would feel really grateful for? It could be a great teacher, it could be a amazing parents, it could be a spouse, it could be just the fact that you have 3 meals a day and a roof on your head. There's so many things that we have that we can be grateful for, and we should count those blessings, and that does make us stronger. And that brings me to the last thing, which is even through all of this stuff, you have to keep your sense of humor. Because if you let your sense of humor go again, it's going to become really hard. And one story in that sense is Mansi Joshi. So Mansi Joshi was this really average badminton player. And she got hit by a truck, literally. And they had to amputate her left leg. And she just won the silver in the Paralympic badminton championships. She's learned scuba diving after her accident. She's traveled all over India and she holds down a job. And she tells the story that when she was in hospital, they had people who would, she would have people who would come to visit her, and they would get all emotional and they would get really upset, and she would start telling them jokes. And that just completely transformed the whole interaction. So, that's what she looks like now. And so as we are finishing off on this whole idea of jokes, I should tell you one about Facebook in jail. Do you guys know what's common in Facebook in jail? So basically everybody has a profile picture. You sit around all day and you write on walls. And you get poked by men you really don't want to know. Thank you. That's all I wanted to say. Q&A.
Tell us about your day. Like, what's a daily day like, and how do you guys manage?
You mean? Mountains? You mean up in Kumam?
Yeah.
So I'm a morning person. Actually, morning person. So like the dawn video and stuff. So I'm usually up around like 4:30, 4:45, and I write for a couple of hours because that's my most creative time. And then through the day, it's not very structured. I'll write some more, I edit, I have to look at the marketing for the Himalayan writing retreats. I blog. Can you pull up the page, by the way? So I have a blog which I've been writing for a year and a half, which is, just keep going now, which is the first one, Uncity blog. So it has about 50 entries on it. It has one on work and identity also, in which there's one called the vice president of something obscure, which I wrote after I moved from here and I've gone up to the mountains. So it's not very structured, but there is always a walk up of about an hour, hour and a half that's in there. And the kids go off to school. We are preparing for another trek, so a lot of it is also... So it kind of varies. But yeah, it starts early and we are usually in bed by 9. Because I'm up at 5. And everybody in the mountains is in bed at 9. And it's perfectly fine to call people at 7 a.m. So it's a very different life cycle that goes on there. Yeah.
What's the model of the writing retreat? Like, people come there and you actually train them to write, or what helps?
So the model is actually, you know, based on personal experience. I was a corporate guy, right? And I always had this dream that I wanted to write a book, but I never got around to it. Then I went to jail and I wrote the damn thing. So it's like, okay, there's obviously a lot of other. And then I got chatting with people and everybody said, "Haan, kitab likhni hai." So I'm like, okay, so I wasn't the only one. There's a lot of these people and everybody has this aspiration that they want to write a book, but they don't have the tools. And so, I have no background in literature. So I just kind of self-taught. I knew how to train because that was my background. So the way that it works is that people come and I don't have a physical location. So I can rent locations and I announce preset dates. And people come and we sit down and we work through, okay, this is the toolkit. Feedback's been fabulous. So that's one thing which is really good. And now a new thing is happening, which is recent, where a couple of organizations have reached out to me and they said, communication is a real problem. Can you help us? So I'm actually doing a program in October with the Ashoka Foundation. They are the guys who do social entrepreneur recognition. Yeah. So I'm working with them, working with 5 of their fellows. One of them wants to write a book. The other 4 want to tell the story much better. So that's happening. American Embassy School is happening. So there's other things which are also evolving along the way. Yeah. Sere? Yes.
So the resilience piece really.
Yes.
Is there, during a time in the jail and in the mountains, is there some way, any good tips and tricks on how you keep it up, how you not let that resilience slowly roll away? Where one day you just like, oh, no. How do you keep it up? How do you keep that attitude?
So I don't think it stays up all the time, but you can't let it go. Okay, this is getting corny now. So you can't expect to always be gung-ho and say, I'm going to get on top of this and this is all just going to be fine. It doesn't happen like that. There were 3 days straight in jail when I didn't eat because I was going through a really rough patch. But then I did get back to it and I did kind of follow through and make sure that I kind of kept the spirit up. Mountains were a little more long drawn, and I think it was actually harder in some ways because the kids are there, your wife is there, everything's looking fine. But when I moved there, I had some amount of consulting going, but then slowly over time, the consulting died out. So then I had to pretty much, and I didn't have a co-founder for the Himalayan Writing Retreat, so it was really my own thing. So I called friends, I had friends who were copywriters from advertising, I called them, got them to help and support, and that's how it took off. But it is going back to that same thing of attitude and toolkit, and you sit down and you say, okay, so what have you got? And you say, okay, I can train, I can write, so is there something that I can create where I don't have to run to the city? But I wanted to do something which I really felt passionate about and I had fun doing. And with Coursera, learning is not hard, So I read a bunch of style guides, I went and spent a lot of time on Coursera, put together a curriculum, and it seemed to have worked. Yes.
What is it that you had to give up in terms of your passions to move into the mountains?
What did I have to give up?
Yeah.
The microbreweries of Gurgaon. That's pretty much it. That's the thing. You get terrible beer in the mountains, so that's really a bummer. Besides that, honestly, I don't miss anything much. But then that's again who I am. Once in a while, you'd want to be hanging out with like good friends. But then when you have a home in the mountains, the friends have a habit of coming pretty often. So even that gets taken care of.
So why cheese and why not microbrewing?
What's that, sir?
Why cheese and why not microbrewing?
So I don't know how to make either. But my co-founder knows how to make cheese.
Great. Sure, thanks.